public housing when you next go to the killers. On them corners, it get better as you go. Grind that motherfucker till it's yellow brick road. Free as a bird, spoken word in my verse. On my knees praying, niggas shooting in the church. Wake up out my sleep in another cold sweat. I lived on billboard, where the fuck to go next? Go against the odds, young and go and get a job. Another country boy, they want back on the farm. So far from my goals, but I'm close to my kids. Don't cry for Mac Dre, nigga throwing up his.
I just wanna be the one.
My good people, some Good Music Monday. I'm your boy Marcus Watson. Welcome to Good Music Monday. We're here to bring y'all some good vibes and pay homage to and respect to some good people doing good things in this good world that we're living in. Okay, I hope everyone had a great weekend. I sure did. You know, playoff football is at its peak right now. I don't know who your team is, but good luck to you. I'm rooting for the Chiefs, the Packers, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and Buffalo. Forget it, you know? No, I'm just playing. But shout out to Patrick Mahomes, for real. I'm rolling with the Chiefs, all right? Yeah, man. Like I said, we're here to bring y'all some good vibes and some more insight on some good people doing good things in this world. I got a few birthday shout outs, though, briefly before we move forward. Last week was my brother's birthday, BG Bop. Happy birthday, BG Bop. Happy birthday today to Ice Burgundy, and happy birthday yesterday, the great, the GOAT himself, Mr. Muhammad Ali. Thank you. And of course, last Friday was Martin Luther King's birthday. You know, happy birthday, Martin Luther King. Thank you for everything that you've done for us, trying to bring unity, you know, into this crazy world that we're living in, but it's a good world. So, you know, appreciate you, Martin Luther King. Rest easy, rest in peace, my brother. And yeah, man, happy birthday to all the Capricorns. You guys see, I bring y'all a guest every week, and today's guest, we have, you know, you guys saw some highlights right there, none other than a three different division world champion, a Olympian, a U.S. Olympian, a businessman, you know, a great commentator, an actor, community leader, great father, and just an all-around solid brother, man. You know, we got to try to get him in here. I don't know if he knows how to work the IG all the way, but yeah, just waiting for him to send that request.
How you doing?
I'm good, King. How you feeling, bro?
I'm good, man. I can't complain. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
No doubt. Thank you, man. Like I say, We this Good Music Mondays, bro. We here to bring good vibes and pay homage to good people doing good things in this good world. And you know, I obviously it's an honor for me to have you right now in front of us and give us some good insight and intellect on Antonio Tarver, because you helped pave the way for a lot of young fighters out there that just has a dream still and is trying to achieve that dream. You're one of the greats, man, and you know, nothing but respect to you, King. Appreciate you.
I appreciate it, man. I appreciate it. You know, we go way back, man. You feel
me? Yes, sir. We're going to get there. Matter of fact, man. Yeah. How's the family doing? How's everybody doing out there? You guys okay with quarantine and stuff?
Man, you know, we staying safe, you know, with this pandemic going on, you know. Man, I'm happy to say that, you know, I dealt with it. I recovered, and I believe because of my conditioning, my training habits, man, I was able to go through that thing without any serious respiratory illness and problems. So, you know, I quarantined, I stayed away, I got well, and I think for the most part, man, when you look at how deadly this thing has been, man, I can truly say that, you know, I was blessed, and I urge everyone to really get on the health kick, man. If you out there, you know, eating bad and not getting your exercise, I mean, that can only hurt your immune system. I mean, exercise, getting that heart rate up and getting that blood flowing good through your veins, I think that's the best thing we can do to combat any virus, is just get healthy.
Yeah, Big facts, bro. That's amazing. That's good. That's good stuff. We need that. Take care of your bodies, people. You know, when you feel like when you don't feel like doing something, go do something. Take a walk. Take a job. You know, do something. So that's good. I like it, AT. So AT, like I said, we're gonna give the people some good vibes and some more insight on you. Looks like it's breaking up. Can you hear me?
I hear you clearly now. Yes, sir.
Yeah, we're gonna give some vibes and some good insight on you, bro. So let's get to it. You were born and raised in Orlando, Florida. You know, can you talk to us about how was that for a young Antonio Tarver, man? You know, like young guy.
Well, you know, it's pretty much the same story that you've heard a million times before. You know, the tough upbringing. You know, not having the best of everything and having to learn how to deal with what you have and be appreciative, but definitely work hard. You know what I mean? That was embedded in me at an early age, and everything I got, I had to earn it. You know what I mean? And I never mind that. I never bothered me to have to dig deep to get it. I mean, I always preferred it that way because, you know, it was more gratifying to me. But yeah, growing up was tough. I mean, you know, that's a tough neighborhood, Ivy Lane. We call it the Pork and Bean Projects. If you know anything about Orlando, you know what that is, right off Ivy Lane. So anybody can tell you that's like, we call it Beirut over there. You feel me?
It's like real.
Playing over there, man. But, you know, I made it through that. And a lot of us made it through that that neighborhood and went on to do great things. And but the great part is, you know, I can still go back and I still get the love like I never left. You know what I mean? Lake Lana Dune Park in Orlando is one of the I think the one of the playgrounds that I became a legend in before I became a legend. You know what I mean? So, you know, the fist of cuffs always been A1. You know what I mean?
I got you, AT. Yeah.
I had to prove that a couple of times out there. You know what I mean? So that didn't have nothing to do with the turnbuckle. That was just straight asphalt. You know what I mean? So, yeah. I did that.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm the Magic Man. You know, I really love my city, my hometown of Orlando, Florida. Everyone knows that I moved to Tampa in 1996 to reunite with my late great trainer, Jimmy Williams, who started me from 10 years old. You know, they had a professional promoter here, the late great Phil Alessi, who was really doing all of the premier boxing in Tampa at the time. Jimmy made his way down here to Tampa, was fortunate enough to work with guys like the Beast Mugabe, you know, another heavyweight guy I can't think right now, Stewart Anthony, was it Alex Stewart? He worked with Alex Stewart, the guy that gave George Foreman a heck of a fight, and a lot of people thought he beat George on the score, you know, the late Alex Stewart, and he also worked with Joey Gamache. So it was imperative for me making a transition from the amateur to the pro to get with a trainer that I knew had the goods. You know, he had the knowledge, he had the teaching aspect. You know, even from a young kid, I learned the fundamentals the right way. You know, 10 years old, I'm rolling, catching, slipping, breaking. You at 10 years old, that's what I was, those are the things that I was taught. Counter punching, you feel me? Defense, catching part, rolling with everything, you know. So my skill set from my trainer has always been, you know, and I think I'm one of the most fortunate fighters to have had some of the greatest trainers. I only had three. Some of the greatest trainers that ever stepped in the ring, man. Buddy McGirt, Orlando Cuellar, and Jimmy Williams. You know, I don't know how you can put three better trainers together in one room. So, you know, that was a great part of my honing my skills, developing my skills, and creating the magic because I had three great trainers, man, that was able to help me along the way.
That's fire. Nah, that's perfectly put, bro. Shoot, you pretty much summed it up for me. I was gonna ask you, you know, how did you get into boxing? You know, what made you get into boxing? How'd you get into boxing? But so was it your first trainer? Like how'd you get into boxing, AT?
You know what, Marcus? I was one of those cats, man. I had a lot of energy. You know, I was paper thin, you feel me? One but a buck or five soaking wet. But just always just been, you know, just been real resilient. And, you know, growing up in Ivy Lane, we used to have to walk to the Boys and Girls Club. It was a local Boys and Girls Club in another neighborhood called Carver Shores, right off Riley Street. And a lot of people used to bus it to Carver Shores from Mercy Drive, Lake Man. So all of the surrounding areas, hoods, they all, you know, migrated at the Boys and Girls Club. So of course, you know, I had my little clique, my little homeboys, everybody had their little homeboys. We always found ourselves getting into it. We always played on the same basketball team, the football team, but these guys would have misagreements. Somebody might take your lunch, you know, your sandwich or some of your snacks, and you have to throw down to protect yours. So it was always that, man. And the director, I'll never forget, his name was Lester Sears. He said, man, if you get in one more fight, I'm gonna put your ass on them gloves and you're gonna learn how to box. That's what he told me. So for my punishment of getting in all these altercations, he put me in the boxing ring, put me on some gloves, and I can say the rest is history, man. I found a love that I had never known. I had never known, but it was one of those things that I couldn't let go, man. And, you know, so here I am almost, you know, I don't want to even say my age, but you know what I mean? That part.
Hey, you know what, AT, I got you. Listen, you like fine wine, bro. I know this, you heard this before, but you like fine wine. You get better with time, bro. You know, look at you, man. So that's a great story, man. Shout out to your first trainer. Shout out to, you know, everyone who put you in the right path, man. One more thing, as a youngin', who were some of your inspirations like growing up? Like who were some guys that, some people that, it may be music artists, it may be athletes, whatever, or neighborhood people, family members, who were some of the guys that you looked up to?
You know, back then, you know, shit, O.J. Simpson was the GOAT. You know what I mean? Shit, back then, you know, Roger Staubach. I was a major Dallas Cowboy fan. Dr. J, you know, before MJ, before LeBron, you know what I mean? So, you know, those are the guys that, Sugar Ray Leonard, Muhammad Ali, you know what I mean? And then the Four Kings, Duran, Hagler, Hearns, you know, Marvin Hagler, who is my idol. You know what I mean? He was my idol coming up in the boxing game. He was a southpaw. He was bald-headed, handsome guy, sort of like myself. You know what I'm saying? So, Marvin Hagler for me, but I love Muhammad Ali. I love Sugar Ray Leonard and all those guys, man. And, you know, those are the guys I took after. But it was Little Red Lopez. It was guys like Livingston Bramble back then. You know, Mancini, Boom Boom Mancini, you know, it was that era, you know, Salvador Sanchez, Azuma Nelson, you know, I can go on and on, you know, but yeah, all those guys paved the way for me, man. I tried to take a little bit from each one of their games, apply it to mine, and make it my own.
Yes, sir. That's perfectly put right there. I like that. I was just with my son, actually, and we watched something on Dr. J, and I had to let him know about Dr. J, you know. He's the guy. You got to know your history, so yeah. Way to go. I appreciate that for sure. Every once in a while in here, AT, we shout out the good people in here. So if I shout out somebody, you know, just disregard it. But shout out to, you know, my mom. Shout out to Brandon in here, Brandon Watson, he in here. Shout out to the good people. Shout out to T. Scotty. So AT, you had a great amateur career, bro. So good you were able to represent the USA in the 1996 Olympics and in Atlanta, Georgia. You feel me? And you won a bronze medal. Can you talk to us about that experience? Like, how was the Olympics and to win the, like, how was that for you, man?
It was unforgettable, Marcus. It was definitely a dream come true. You know, after watching Roy Jones get robbed in the Seoul career, in the Seoul Olympic Games, I got off the couch, you know, at that moment. And I ran 3 miles, never not really knowing, you know, where I would end up. But I knew I couldn't look back. You see what I'm saying? So that was really a rebirth for me. It's something after watching that every round, I watched it and I'm like, man, and they robbed him, you know, something right here kind of said, you know what, I want to, you know, it was the dream of going to get that gold medal that eluded Roy was built, was in me, was born that moment. I ran 3 miles and I never looked back. You know, my life at that time was in a mess. You feel me? The book will be out, The Greatest Story Never Told. That'll be coming out this year. But at that moment, something came over me. And I knew I had, I didn't know what my future would hold at that time. But I knew after seeing Roy Jones on TV, I knew it was better than what I was giving myself at that moment. And Roy really inspired me. A lot of people don't understand this. They think it was like, oh, I never chased Roy Jones. He was just in my way. It wasn't like I went after him or anything. You know, so that was the moment when I saw Roy, that all my Olympic dreams, you know, was kind of born. And yeah, that's why when I got robbed in 1992 in the regional Olympic trials, they gave Richard Barnes a victory over me. And so my 92 Olympic dreams was kind of dashed like that. You know, I had just came on the scene the year before the Olympics. So I won the regionals and I was able to go to the nationals. I won about, I think, two fights, and then I lost to Richard Barnes, and I was hurt over that, man. I was really hurt because I knew I won the fight. You know, Montel Griffin represented the country in 92. Great fight. I think he won the silver medalist. He was a silver medalist and eventually ended up being a world champion. He was the first guy to get a victory over Roy. And we end up fighting in our professional career where I beat him for my first world titles, the WBC and the IBF, when I unified those titles on the undercard of James Toney and the eventual 96 gold medalist, Vasily Jirov. So, you know, being on that card, the undercard, me winning my titles, and then James Toney beating him to become the cruiserweight champion, it was kind of a feel-good in a way. You know, me winning my titles and him losing his on the same night. Kind of like, not really. I didn't get revenge, but I kind of felt like I won more than he won in my professional career. You feel me? I think I did that. I kind of, with becoming five-time champion, I kind of outshined the guy that they say beat me in the Olympics, basically.
Facts. Okay. I got you. And then you end up.
I want to say this before I finish. That 96 Olympic team was one of the greatest Olympic teams ever assembled. And people, we don't get enough credit because of the legendary fighters that the other 84, you know, the Olympic team, 76, those guys, they had some living legends. And we had a few too. I think we had one in Mayweather,
Give us a few. Now, we want to hear a few that was on the 96 joint. Give us a few. Give us some, babe.
I mean, of course, David Reed, the eventual gold medalist who knocked out, you know, Duval Hall, a great Cuban Olympic gold medalist, knocked him out with about 15 seconds left to win the only gold medal in 96. Now, you have to wrap your mind around this. We had seven fighters go to the actual semifinals. Seven fighters. You know, a lot of people felt I got robbed. A lot of people felt Floyd got robbed. We should have been fighting for that gold medal. I think when you look at guys like Fernando Vargas, you know, David Diaz, guys like Lawrence Claybe, Nate Jones, Rasheed Wells. Who am I missing? Gerardo, and as well as one of my favorite fighters, Eric Morrell from that Olympic team, 96, man. And you got Pretty Boy Floyd, you know, in case a lot of people don't know, I named him his first moniker now. I gave him that name, Pretty Boy Floyd. You know what I'm saying? I ain't mad at him for changing it to money. I would have changed it to money too, you feel?
Yes, sir. Hey, but nah, AT, everybody knows, you know, I still call him PB, Pretty Boy. So that's Pretty Boy Floyd, man. So yeah, way to go. Thank you, AT, for that. That's amazing.
And Pretty Boy was a bad boy, man. He was a bad boy younger. Yeah, I love it.
Okay. But there you go.
One of the greatest of all time, 50-0, TBE, the best ever. You know, heads up to my Olympic teammate, Pretty Boy Floyd.
That's right. That's tight, man. That's well said, AT. That sounds like a lot of fun, and that's amazing that you were able to be a part of history, you know, as far as fighting with those greats. And you brought home a medal. You understand? So you brought home the medal. So shout out, major shout out to you, AT. You brought home that bronze medal. So thank you, man. Thank you for everything you do for us, you know, our country, for our you know, our country, black folks, you know, I got to say that too. And everything you do for us, bro, for giving us inspiration and motivation. Shout out to you, AT.
Appreciate it, bro.
Antonio, real quick too. I'm wearing this shirt. It's a free J Red. This is my bro, J Red. He's in the penitentiary serving time for something, you know, that he shouldn't be serving this much time for. But so I'm wearing this, and shout out to my brother J Red. That's one thing.
Shout out. Get on soon, bro.
Yes, sir. So AT, last thing on your amateur career, bro. Can you give us three of the toughest guys that you faced in the amateurs? That you face, period. Give me three. I know you face a lot, but three of the toughest guys you face.
Okay, Marcus, can you pin me on this? Can you pin me on here so my people can see where I'm at and what I'm doing here? I don't know how to pin this joint.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure it out too, AT. I'm with you, though.
Y'all know how to pin this thing, man.
Let me see. But it's going to be saved. I'm sending it regardless, you know.
Okay, good. All right. Well, I'm going to tell you, man, the toughest fighter I ever faced in the amateurs was Cuban legend Ramon Garvey, man. Ramon Garvey was a great fighter. Southpaw, had it all.
Okay.
Amateur. Byron Mitchell, man. Byron Mitchell. We fought about 4 or 5 times, man. Byron Mitchell was a tough cat. Ended up being super middleweight champion.
Sweet.
Amateur. Oh, Anthony Stewart. Anthony Stewart from Chicago. I always had to meet him in the finals, man. So shout out to Anthony Stewart from Chicago. Those two guys, all three of those guys made sure that I brought my best. But, yeah, the Cuban sensation, Ramon Garvey was the best talented fighter I may have faced, you know, in the amateurs. He really showed me that going to the body really works. Because I remember struggling to get off that stool in the third round.
And them body shots will make you almost want to say, hey, time out. What's going on here?
For real though, man.
Yeah. Trust me, I know. I've never been nowhere near you guys' level, but I had my fair share of like street fights and, you know, just, you know, messing around. And yeah, you realize early, yeah, you catch like the right guy catch you in the body at the right with the right place, it'll slow you down for sure, you know.
When you exhale and then he punching, that's it, all the air go.
Yeah, you'd be like, wait, what the heck? So that's amazing. That's good stuff, AT. I like that. AT, let me ask you, so around those times, around your amateur times and Olympic times, what kind of music were you vibing to, bro? We
want
to know what kind of music.
Yeah, Tupac, you know, that was 95, 94, you know what I mean? Tupac, yeah. You know,
Biggie,
of course. Biggie, yeah, back then. They was killing the airwaves back then. It wasn't nothing else. You was either with them or against them. So you had to pick a side.
But
East Coast, West Coast.
That's it. Okay, I like that, man. How about but what about some Florida stuff though, AT? Who's the Florida guys popping?
Oh, you know, we had Trick Daddy. Trick Daddy stayed out there. Mm-hmm. That was before Plies time, but Plies right now doing us good. Yeah. It's a lot of guys from Florida. Bobby Shmurda, it's a lot of guys from Florida that don't rep Florida.
You know,
Ace Hood. You know, it's a lot of guys out there from Florida but don't rep Florida. And you know, but I'm biased, man. I like my guys that I know. Slim E from Orlando and my boy Granddaddy South. You know what I mean? Remember Granddaddy South.
He brought
me out for the first Roy Jones fight. Yeah.
I remember Granddaddy South, bro. Granddaddy South was strong. He always was strong too. Always, man. I like Granddaddy South.
Yeah.
That's what's up, AD.
You know, we had Luther Campbell, legendary Luther, Luke Skywalker, you feel me? Those guys back in the days, yeah.
Shout out to Uncle Luke, man. Shout out to Granddaddy South too, man. Good stuff, yeah. AT. All right. AT, so you go on and you turn pro, and you made your pro debut February 18th, 1997, and you scored a second round knockout. Okay. What was the feeling for you, bro? Was it the same feeling as as any other fight, or was it different for your debut?
It was much different, man. I was getting paid for the work now. You feel me? It wasn't no more trophies. Wasn't no more medals. You feel me?
Yeah.
I fight, I win, I get paid. And that was the difference. Yeah. And we could really see the money. You feel me?
Yeah, I got you. Okay. That's tight, AT. All right. So, okay. So, look, there you go. There you go, whooping some ass right there, bro.
Yeah, that's me at the Blue Horizon, man. I had my first couple fights at the great legendary Blue Horizon in Philadelphia, PA. It was one of the best venues there because all of the fans was right on top of you. Uh-oh. He got hit with that magic wand then.
Wait. What'd you call it, the magic wand, AT?
The magic wand, boy. You get touched with that, something gonna move.
I like it. Hey, shout out to all my good people in here one time. And if you guys have any questions, you can send me a question, and I may ask Antonio Tarver one of your questions. AT, with the magic wand, that's good, man. So now, let's go. You're doing great. You're going on having a stellar professional career. And then you get Roy Jones Jr., brother, the chosen one. Roy Jones Jr. is the chosen one, you know. Shout out to Roy too. He changed the game, you know. He did his thing right.
He had a birthday too. Happy birthday to the legend Roy Jones Jr. He had a birthday yesterday.
Definitely, yeah. Happy birthday. Yeah, major happy birthday. Shout out to him. So you go on and face Roy Jones Jr. and you guys have some classic fights. These are historic boxing matches. The first one, you fell short. But I got to ask, did you feel like you won that first fight against Roy Jones Jr.?
Undoubtedly. Okay. I felt like I beat him at a boxing match. You know what I mean? I beat him skill for skill. I think, I outpunched him. I dictated the fight. I controlled the action. You know, even when we were in the middle of the ring, I held my own. And I don't think I got hit with anything really significant. Caught me with a couple, you know, right hands and whatnot. I saw him coming. But, you know, when you look at the onslaught that I put on Roy Jones for basically the whole fight, I mean, come on, man. If you're judging it by the criteria of boxing, there's no way you can judge that fight. And so far out, you know, it wasn't even a close fight. One judge had him 117-111. You know, so it's like, come on, man, who we had up there, you know, blind mice, you know, judging the fight. But it happened for a reason. And I think it was necessary for me to go back to the drawing board, feeling everything I felt, feeling as if my world was taken from me. And I think I needed to go back to the drawing board with a chip on my shoulder, because I knew in my heart of all hearts, I couldn't let it go. I convinced myself that I couldn't let it go to the scorecards. And that's basically what it was, man. And so I was so hell-bent on stopping him within the distance. I told everybody that would listen, even in the buildup of the fights, what would happen. Matt Kellerman, you know, all of the guys, the commentators for HBO at the time. Any interview I had, anybody asked me, I'm taking it out of the judge's hand. It won't go to it. Don King at the pre-fight press conference, he got me. The Superman outfit, he got the boots and everything. I smashed the boots. And say right. it won't be no flights taken now, you know, tonight. No. So I just felt convinced, man, that it was my time. And with everything I had gone through in life, I felt like it was a buildup to that moment, you know. So, you know, that's how I approached it. And, you know, the results were what they were. And I think when you look at the three fights that we did have, I mean, a fool would say that you can make any excuse. I mean, but this boxing, it ain't no excuses. This boxing, it ain't no excuses. Go ahead.
No, that's facts, AT. But no, you say three. See, you guys had three classic fights, bro. These are like, these are things that I'm going to tell my kids about, my son about, my son going to tell his son about that. You know, these are generational fights, which you did, bro. I feel like you won, too. And that, I got to be honest with you right here, live, too, AT. I don't know if I ever told you this.
I know you better than just me, right?
I'm a Roy Jones dear guy. So I was messing with him, right?
You had him and picked. You had him picked.
I like Roy Jones Jr. for sure, but I couldn't have had him picked because I knew the whole situation now. You know, it was family now. I'm like, well, I'm rolling with my guy. And AT, you shocked me because I'm a young buck, bro. I didn't know too much about you all the way. You know, so I see you and I'm like, wait, this dude is serious. This is southpaw. He putting pressure on Roy Jones Jr. right here. And Roy don't like it. And you just had his number to me. That's how I look at the whole trilogy. I think you just had his number, you know? That's just what it is, I feel like, you know? You just knew you could whoop him whenever you wanted to. And Roy, it's not to take nothing away from Roy Jones Jr. Like, he's an amazing fighter, but that's to give credit to what you do, Will. You know, you're an amazing fighter.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, we all love Roy. I mean, but what did the people expect me to do?
Right.
Because I ain't never paid homage to no fighter when it came down to me competing against him. I mean, how the hell can you beat someone you idolize him? You feel me? That's just not, that don't even, I can't even fathom that. Like, you can't put nobody before yourself. It's right. What I've been trying to tell people my whole career. You can't put nobody before yourself. I don't care what they made. If you're on a basketball court, you can't put Jordan before you. You gotta go at him. You got to know that you have everything it takes to be just as great. And if you ain't looking at it like that, then you in the wrong sport, period.
Facts. And look, that's perfectly put right there, man. You got to believe in yourself to achieve something great. And you believe in yourself and you achieve something ultra great. And you were the first man in history to knock out Roy Jones Jr. You understand what I'm saying? Like, and that's what you did. And you knew you could do it. Because you always felt, I could tell you went back to your years as a child. You just knew everything that you did coming to that point, you were going to be the better man in that fight. And you did it, AT. And major salute, major shout out to you. Shout out to Brandon Watson. You was there as well. You remember that? We remember that, man. You know, the classic time. Shout out to my boy, Nick Long, one of my favorite pitchers in the real. Nick Long, he's in here. Shout out to the good people. Nick. That's tight, man. So look, Roy. I mean, I'm sorry, I called you Roy. Now he said Roy, AT.
We're not together. Don't worry about it.
I know that's your brother. Speaking of which, before I go to the next question, did they ever come at you with you know, he fought Mike Tyson? Did they come at you with wanting to fight, you know, one of these greats of, you know, wanting to do this legendary fighting that Mike Tyson and them got? Like, or no?
Well, they didn't come at me with it, but they know if they come at me with it, what it is, you know what I mean? But no, yeah. I feel like I like what the Legend League is doing, what it stands for. But yeah, I mean, that would be great. I feel like a Holyfield or Mike Tyson would be great for the Magic Man. You know what I mean? Mike Tyson was 2 years older than me.
You open to it, Antonio? You open to it? You open to doing it? You saying?
I'm open to doing it, of course, yeah. I like it. I like the exhibition, you know what I mean? Exhibition, you feel me? And I can show the world what I still got, you feel me? I can show the miracle of the Magic Man. To this day, I can show them the miracle of the Magic Man, bro, for real.
Right, and I know what you got, AT. Hey, whoever you fight, I'll put my money on you, AT. I'm going to win something, I'll tell you that much. AT. But look, what I was going to ask you, though, after you beat Roy Jones Jr., that took your career to a whole nother level. I don't know if you know that or not, but I seen it with my own eyes, man. Yeah. The whole world, it took your career to a whole nother level. It's like, wait, who is this guy that just knocked out Roy Jones Jr.? Hey, and before you knocked him out, you got the classic phrase. You say, are there any excuses? What would you say? Any excuses you got now, Roy?
Yeah, Jay Nady asked me a question, and I said, yeah, I got a question. You have any excuses tonight, Roy? And so, yeah, that was major, man. And I'm glad things turned out like they did because, man, I could have been the laughingstock of the sport. And, man, if things would have went wrong that night, I probably would have never been heard from again, man. But sometimes you just got to go out on faith, man. And that's what I did.
And you did, like I say, and it took you to your career to a whole other level. You end up co-starring in a film that's like, these are historical classic movies that everybody knows about, Rocky Balboa. You end up co-starring with Sylvester Stallone in a movie, Rocky Balboa, as Mason Dixon. Shout out to Mason Dixon, by the way.
Yeah, Mason Dixon, man. Undisputed.
Cool with history. So look, you end up co-starring with Rocky, with Sylvester Stallone and Rocky. Can you talk to us, the good people, about that experience? Like, how did that come about? How did you end up getting that part? And also, how was the experience on set with Sylvester Stallone and them guys?
Well, I met Stallone after the Olympics. He flew me in. We had a red carpet event right there in Orlando at Planet Hollywood. His whole entire family, his wife, kids, and everything, my family. And we sat down and chopped it up. I had my my lawyer at the time, John Morgan, for the people from Orlando, one of the biggest law firms in the state. We just had a great time. And because of, I was getting a lot of press in the amateurs going to the Olympics. And Sly saw my personality. He knew I was, boisterous, outspoken, and I let my character show a lot in my amateur days. So I guess it piqued his interest then. But as my professional career developed and the Magic Man became more prevalent, I guess it was the idea that he thought about. And I got that familiar voice going to train for one of my one of the Roy Jones fights. I forget which one it was, the third one or either the second one, but I got that familiar voice, and he asked me, would I mind, playing alongside him in Rocky Balboa? I'm like, what do I sign up? I mean, you think I'm going to say that? Man, come on, bro. Stop playing. So the thing was, I couldn't really tell anyone until after the fight, man. That was the whole thing. I had to keep it on mute. I think one other person knew. You know who that was,
Yeah. Facts.
He's the only one knew, yeah.
Major fight. That is amazing, bro. That's a tight story. And, I was an outsider looking in, but I knew how good that was treating you. I remember my dad would go meet you at the, over in Beverly, the hotel.
In the movie with me, yeah.
Cool Seasons. Yeah, they had you. You was right. I know that. You was right.
They took care of me good out there.
Sam, love you too, man. You know that. Shout out to my pops, man.
What's up, Sam?
Yes, sir. AT, that's good, man. So then, AT, that's amazing, bro. Would you be open and willing to do more acting?
Of course, man. I think, it came natural for me. When you consider that was my first movie, never acted before, never read leads or anything. And just to get out there and Sly take me up under his wing, man, we rehearsed a lot. So he made sure everything, I was on point. And I made sure I knew my lines, even though, sometimes it was hard getting up in Vegas and meeting that roll call, you feel me? Because, I was still the champ then, so a lot of late nights out.
I got you. Hey, I hear you.
Be late for anything, because I learned early on, time is money when you shoot movies. And ain't nobody wasting no time in that game. So I learned that lesson real quick.
That's tight, man. So hey, any film directors, any film producers, if y'all seeing this right now, please feel free to reach out. Any casting directors, please feel free to reach out to Antonio Tarver. He's willing and open to do some movies, man. Hey, I got a question from MLB Dodger. MLB Dodger asks, any chance at a B-Hop versus Tarver rematch with all these nostalgic matches making big money? Would you want to fight B-Hop again?
I mean, at one time I did, but I think that's water under the bridge right now. A lot of things that, went on behind closed doors in that fight. And, you know, I'm gonna shine a little light on that in my book. I'm not gonna get into it now, but if you go back, I'm sure if anybody know their history, everyone know how I felt about that fight. And, you know, I'm never gonna say or think that I couldn't lose to Bernard Hopkins. Bernard is a great fighter, just like all of the greats in that time, in that era. But amateur or pro, I've never been outclassed in a boxing match. But on one day, that dreadful day in New Jersey, where at that time, you can really say, after knocking out Roy Jones and shooting that Rocky movie, I'm basically the biggest face in the game at that time. Even though it was fleeting, because after that loss, I lost my status as a champion. Even though I gained the titles back several times since then, it's a difference when you don't have the status as a champion, even though you're carrying a belt. And if you know boxing, you know what I'm talking about. I had to fight for my status after losing to Bernard Hopkins. It was a tier that it felt like I just couldn't reach. You understand? Mm. Because I lost to Hopkins, they put me beneath everybody. And that just wasn't the case. Because the way you find out how fights should go is you do common opponents. You do common opponents. Look at the opponents that Bernard Hopkins and I have had. Now, on skill, and Bernard is a great fighter, but there's no way he dominate me and blow me out like he did. Come on, man. Something was in the water. Something was in the water against Bernard Hopkins, and I'm going to prove it. I'm going to prove it. All these years later, I'm going to uncover that mystery.
I hear
you. Somebody know what happened. Somebody know definitely what happened.
Okay. Now, I like that. See, I never knew that, AT, and we never knew that. So thank you, brother, for giving us that insight right there.
I'm going to say this, not to cut you off. The reason I wouldn't give Bernard, I don't want to fight Bernard, because if he claim he a man like he say, look, man, I didn't have to fight Bernard Hopkins. The man wasn't in my weight class. He was moving up two weight classes. He was coming off two losses to Jermaine Taylor. What I'm doing in the ring with Bernard Hopkins, make that make sense. He ain't in my weight class. He's not. He's coming up from two losses, and I couldn't get a rematch clause.
Come on, crazy.
I couldn't get it. After I gave him a lifeline, he couldn't even honor a rematch clause, bro. So he can honor a rematch, regardless if he had a clause or not. Bro.
Right.
But you chase Roy Jones for 15 years trying to secure a rematch.
That's crazy.
So
that's
crazy. Don't nothing make sense? If it don't make sense, then that should tell you what happened in the fight. So,
that's crazy. See, thank you, AT. Thank you for shedding that light, because a lot of us felt a way, but thank you for shedding that light, because now we can really wrap our minds around something and actually things that make you go, you know, like that's it, man.
Exactly.
Hey, shout out to my homegirl, Skull Praise, in here. She sells some good immunity shots that, you know, with ginger, with a lot of good stuff that opens you up. Shout out to Skull Praise, good stuff. And all right, AT, can you give us three of the toughest fights that you fought as a pro? Three of the toughest guys. Give us three of those, man.
Man, Eric Harding, both of them. The first fight when he beat me, and the second fight when I knocked him out. It still was a tough fight, you know what I mean? And of course, I think Roy Jones, because the bar was set so high, and I had to reach it. Yeah, he brought the best out of me. You know, he was my biggest challenge.
That's tight. And now one more. I need one more. One more.
Danny Green hit me harder than I ever been hit before.
Danny Green.
He hit me so hard in the eighth round, I knew I had to knock him out in the ninth.
You did too. That's And like I said, that's no shade to everybody that you fight, because just in case you guys didn't know out there, good people, every fight that these warriors, all these boxers, these warriors go through, no fight is easy. A fight is a fight, okay? Just know that. Yeah. So AT, you also are one of the, you're one of my favorite commentators ever, for real. You're one of the best commentators to ever do it because you speak the facts and you've also taught me something. You're very articulate, like this is you, bro. So can you give us three of the toughest, three of the best fights that you call as a commentator?
Yeah, Sugar Shane Mosley, Manny Pacquiao. That was a great fight. We call that
Mosley,
one.
Manny.
Sugar Shane Mosley, Manny Pacquiao. I'll never forget traveling to Nottingham, England, covering that fight over there with Arthur Abraham and Andre Durrell. That was a big fight. Yeah. That was a six tournament. Watching Andre Ward win the Super Six for USA. And defeating all those guys from the UK and proving to the world that he was one of the best fighters pound for pound. I was right there for the whole thing from beginning to end. Commentating the Super Six was definitely a feather in my cap from a commentating position.
Facts. That's what's up, man. Shout out to my Uncle Bobby Brown in here. Shout out to Ellie Sackbeck. Ellie Sackbeck reporting. He does a great job. Shout out to Fight Hype and that's good. Those are great fights. I was there in Nottingham too, man, at those fights. That Super Six was some good stuff. I was there, AT. So listen, in 2014, AT, your son, Antonio Tarver Jr., has his first professional boxing match, and he wins by TKO. How did you feel, bro, seeing your son go out there and, leave it all in the ring and come out victorious? How did you feel as a father?
I felt great. I mean, it was one of those things where he chose and decided to pick up the gloves. It wasn't anything that I've ever tried to steer him in because, I know boxing is a tough sport and, it ain't for everyone, But I will say this. After seeing his abilities in the ring, his natural abilities, man, I wish I would have kind of steered him to the ring. I think that he would have probably found love for the game a lot sooner in his life. But he's been ringside watching my entire career. He's been in the trenches with me my entire career. So he's been watching one of the best, and he's developed his own style, even though it looks a lot like mine. But he's developed his own style. And I believe even at his right age now of 32, I think if he ever really got serious about the game, he can shake it up just like I did. I really believe that because, with me training him and with me in his corner and in his head and giving him, all of the inspiration and motivation, I think he can be as great as he want to be. He just has to make it up in his mind because I can't fight for him. I can't fight for nobody.
Facts. See, and that's well said, and I agree with you 100%. AT, I was fortunate enough to be a part of your child, AT Junior's boxing career and bringing him up, and he has all the skill, bro. He's got everything that you need. So it's up to him to want to achieve great things and put it in his mind and do it. But even if he doesn't, shout out to Antonio Jr. no matter what, because he did it, He got in that ring. So look, hey, AT, and I also just showed that Roy Jones knockout too, by the way.
Hey, you made a lot of people mad, man.
Hey, that's a part of the game, baby. That's what you got to do in life. The game. The greats are always going to make somebody mad. It's okay. AT, if you could fight three guys from any era, any generation, any weight class, who would you want to share the ring with?
Most definitely at light heavyweight, Michael Spinks, because I think he was the greatest light heavyweight of all times. And if anybody could bring the best out of me, it would be a guy like Michael Spinks. Man, I would say Marvin Hagler, but I don't want them problems. You know what I mean? He's a southpaw, big puncher, you feel me? But just to say I've been there with the great Marvin Hagler would be a great, great story. And, of course, man, I think Joe Calzaghe, man. I think Joe Calzaghe was a fight that could have been made a fight that should have been made. But for whatever, he didn't want to dance with the Magic Man. You feel me? So Joe Calzaghe was another guy I think got away with that old. You feel me?
Wow. Hey, look, AT, I love it. Those are three greats. And AT, that's a trip because one of my, well, not one, my favorite European fighter of all time is Joe Calzaghe. You know, he's amazing, right? And listen, bro, I didn't know that he didn't want to dance with you because that means he kind of dodged. He dodged that. He could have, that O would have been gone. He faced AT, probably, you know?
I think if anybody could have beat Calzaghe, it was a guy that had the speed, had the rhythm, and had the power. And if you look back at his two fights with the two American, the great American fighters he faced, he got dropped by Hopkins. He got dropped by Roy. If those guys are dropping him, I'm putting him, man, you feel me? If they're dropping him, I'm knocking him. You feel me?
AT, I'm gonna leave it there because I'm gonna leave it there because now you're gonna make me second guess my guy Joe because all this time I didn't know that Joe didn't want the funk, he didn't want the action with you, bro, but that's okay. Shout out to Chase Melton and Ting Melton in here. Ting Melton is my little niece cousin. She's one of the best tennis players in the world. She's only like two, but wow. She's amazing.
Wow.
So yeah, man, that's good stuff. So AT, we only got about 2 minutes left. So let's go with, talk to us about your gym briefly, bro. I know you opened up a gym out there in Florida. Can you give us what's the name? How can we find information? What's going on?
Well, Signature Punch Boxing is at Punch Fitness, 4913 West Waters Avenue in Tampa. I mean, I don't train a lot of people, but I got about 7-8 clients that I train regularly. But man, I've been reached out to from some of the big names in the UK. Can't really put it out there in public right now, but I'm working and talking to one guy in particular. And if things work out, I think this will be some huge news for boxing, you know, with me being a trainer. You know, I've just been waiting. You know, I put my name in the hat for Wilder. I think a guy with as much ability as Wilder, I think, you know, he could use a real solid teacher that can truly, you know, show him how this thing really go, man. And all I think he needs is a guy to get a better understanding of range and distance and rhythm and timing. And that's it. And that's what boxing is. But you have to be able to have someone that can truly get that message across to you. You feel me? Like really work on that mindset type of thing. And it's a lot to go that goes into boxing. I can't really spell it all out right now, but it's more than just catching mitts. Man, you gotta know how to inspire someone. You gotta know how to motivate someone. You gotta know how to get things out of a fighter that he didn't even know he had in him. And that's what I'm trying to do. It's only going to take one, and the first one is going to be the blueprint for all the others to come. You know, I know what I possess is unique, and I know it ain't going to take but a little bit of magic to sprinkle on these guys to really light that fire in them and light that bulb off in their head so they can truly realize their potential. All of it.
Hey, that's perfect, bro. Hey, Wilder, you here, man. We're going to try to figure out how you can get right with AT, man. Hey, everybody, follow Antonio Tarver on all platforms. How do they follow you on all platforms? What's your social media?
All platforms, social media is at Antonio Tarver. And I just want to say follow my new platform in mental health, Project 100. Project 100 is what we're doing now on a mental health standpoint. Project 100 Entertainment. So I've been putting up posts. We got our first exhibition January 24th. All of the information is online, and I'm looking forward to that. You know, we got Kelly Pavlik involved. We have
a lot of greats.
Dubs involved, and we want to get these gamers involved and a lot of more noteworthy athletes to get involved. So live with the exhibition. 2011 Fight Night coming live, virtual, January 24th. Don't miss it.
AT, give us, we got about 40 seconds left. One of your favorite songs of all time, just give us the name of one of your favorite songs. We don't have time to play it, but give us, what's one of your songs that gets you going? What's one of the
Matt Fatten and Whitehead, Ain't No Stopping Us Now, baby. You know that one. Mm-hmm. Larry Holmes, come in with it.
AT, I love it. Shout out to him. I'm going to leave you with this. This is one of my favorite songs. Everybody go check out that movie, One Night in Miami, on Amazon Prime right now. This is one of my favorite songs forever right here. Mr. Sam Cooke, you know.
Change my life. Oh, this should be a